nerds.
Nerds! Nerds!
What is a nerd?
One of the more interesting prospects of the recent movie reboot The Amazing Spider-Man was its promise to offer audiences a fresh take on Peter Parker, updating the quintessential nerd superhero for a 21st century where the whole idea of the nerd had changed considerably. Instead, what the film offered was a tall, attractive, athletic, fashionably brooding Peter who seemed for all the world to be a composite of everything trendy and desirable in a high school heartthrob, who for some reason is still referred to and treated as the puny, dweeby, dateless Wonder Parker of the mid-1960s, despite all evidence to the contrary. The dissonance there was easy enough to understand. It was a slapdash movie rushed into production by people who didn't really give a damn about whether or not it was good. But it does, perhaps accidentally, fall in line with the way the broader cultural perception of the nerd has changed in some respects, and not at all in others. But has it really? Where did it all come from in the first place? Would you be surprised if I told you that what we consider to be evergreen nerd stereotypes, and even the word itself, are only a handful of decades old? Let's get the etymology out of the way here. The word nerd was invented by Dr. Seuss to describe a fictional animal in his 1950 book If I Ran the Zoo. According to Newsweek magazine, it was at some point shortly thereafter adopted as a new synonym for square, i.e. a young person who wasn't part of this or that counterculture, by teenagers in Detroit, Michigan. From there, it appeared in various other forms sporadically throughout the 50s and 60s, though since mimetic evolution of slang was hard to track in the days before mass communication, it's possible multiple usages sprang up independently of one another. One of my favorites being the notion that the proper spelling was actually nerd, i.e. drunk spelled backwards to denote someone who didn't like to party. Geek, incidentally, didn't used to be synonymous with nerd or any of its other attendant connotations. Geek originally referred to the human attractions at circus freak shows, and then got repurposed as a general insult for weird or unusual persons, then got grabbed up alongside every other once-derisive slang term as part of the pseudo-ironic nerd pride phenomenon of the 21st century, and stuck better than most because, well, probably because it made a cute rhyme with chic, honestly, but we'll come back to that. In any case, nerd as a universal identifier for the terminally unhip didn't really seep fully into the popular culture until it became a go-to insult on the TV series Happy Days, which was made in the 70s but set in the 50s, thus creating the appearance that the idiom nerd was both long-lived and widespread. However, one thing that wasn't immediately present during this establishment of nerd identity was the secondary component. Nerd did not originally also denote high intelligence. Remember, from World War II up through the early 60s, especially once the atomic age got underway, skill in science and technology were largely idealized, as best seen in the iconic imagery of the two-fisted macho scientist of 1950s comics and B-movies. The brains-brawn binary concept, aka the dumb-jock-smart-nerd dynamic, wasn't in any real way entrenched in the popular culture yet. Sure, casual slurs like bookworm, egghead, and brainiac had long been tossed around, ditto for the weak-willed, overly studious persons themselves, but the modern conception of high intelligence equaling social ostracism and vice versa is just that, a modern concept of fairly recent vintage. So where did it come from? Where did Sheldon, Dexter, Urkel, Screech, and Mark I Peter Parker all come from in the first place? Well, it's hard to pinpoint, actually. It definitely came into full bloom in the mid-1960s, and for some, the answer is as simple as pointing out that they all could simply have been reworkings of Jerry Lewis's then-popular Nutty Professor persona. On the other hand, and I'm going to phrase this as carefully as I possibly can, when you look at the stock characteristics of the post-60s nerd archetype, i.e. extremely high-skilled in very specific cognitive fields, introversion, difficulty in social situations, said archetype runs somewhat parallel to the high-functioning end of what's called the autism spectrum. Is it possible that the classical nerd stereotype were in fact simply caricatures of folks with conditions that weren't generally recognized as conditions by the public at large until fairly recently? I honestly don't know, and I do know that that line of thought inevitably leads into hairy areas of discussion like overdiagnosis and flexible boundaries, but it is an interesting notion, and I'm seeing it raised more and more lately. Whatever the origin, nerd became one of the great go-to stock characters all throughout the 70s, 80s, and 90s, beloved by movies and TV for their dual use as both punchline and problem solver, and further emboldened by the increased visibility of real-life nerds as the home electronics market exploded stateside. Class, what follows visibility? Pride. So even though the nerd was still largely a negative and/or comical archetype in popular culture, it became more and more common for folks in real life to self-identify as such, particularly in the wake of gimmicky movies like Revenge of the Nerds and the unexpected ubiquity of Steve Urkel. And as the 90s bled into the 2000s and the mainstreaming of the World Wide Web began rewriting the culture itself, these were often the folks holding the pen. Today, nerd, often used interchangeably with geek, is less an identifier of type, though said types are still part of the stock character toolkit, than it is a commodified lifestyle label now that once nerd-dominated fields of interest are more widely popular. And while there are probably just as many, if not more, fictional nerds on TV and in movies as ever, and certainly as many in real life, it does kind of feel like the old model sheets are less and less stable, to the degree that they ever were. There was always more than a note of rosy self-aggrandizement to the conceit that quote-unquote nerdy or geeky interests made one a nerd and thus qualified them as default intellectuals. The relative quality of internet discourse on the subject of video games or comic book movies these days can attest that this is very much not the case. We've also had to retire the comfortable notion of the nerd as quintessentially decent soul, given the rise of the program e-commerce scene in the ever-booming tech sector. And maybe that's all for the best. As I hope I've somewhat demonstrated, nerd was always a nebulous thing. Labels have their place. They help us organize our thoughts and perceptions, but we ought to control them, not the other way around. What is a nerd? Well, if you feel like you are one, then I guess it's you. What is nerd culture? Whatever you want it to be, or to have been. Maybe that takes a bit more mental gymnastics than simply saying nerd equals pocket protector, thick glasses, and blueprints to the Enterprise, but if we nerds really are as clever as we've always considered ourselves to be, I think we can handle it. I'm Bob, and that's The Big Picture.